After more than 20 years, the Land Rover Defender is back. And while it has seemingly nailed that charming retro vibe, under the surface, things are thoroughly modern. Which is good, because today we're going to put it to the test, on and off-road. The new Defender is definitely a handsome-looking thing, and certainly does catch the attention of passers-by. Upright and boxy by nature, it does still tie into the rest of the Land Rover lineup, thanks to this simple front end with this Land Rover grille and the Defender script. While my personal favorite look on the Defender were the early prototypes on the steely style wheels, in the US we get 19s as standard, though our test vehicle does have the optional 20s and the optional off-road tires, which really do complete the look in my opinion. Speaking of the look, this shorter two-door Defender 90, which denotes the length of the wheelbase, looks so much more punchy and aggressive in person than the longer four-door Defender 110. Though I suppose it's a matter of preference and practicality, but if you can swing it, this is definitely the cooler looking of the two. I love what Land Rover's done back here and just lopped off the rear of the car, again, keeping with the aggressive theme. But contrasting it really nicely, in my opinion, are these really small, delicate LED taillights that do bring it thoroughly into the 21st century. Visually, overall, I think Land Rover's done a great job of recognizing the Defender heritage, but making this design feel very modern. A 296 horsepower 2-liter turbo 4 is the standard engine here, and it's quite good. However, our test vehicle has the upgrade. This is a new engine to the Land Rover family of vehicles. It's a 3-liter straight six that is both supercharged and turbocharged and has a 48-volt mild hybrid assist system, and the combined power output is a massive 395 horsepower and 406 pound-feet of torque. However, if that's not enough for you, for whatever reason, if you have 100 grand to depart with, Land Rover will happily drop in their bonkers supercharged 5-liter V8 under the hood of this thing to produce 516 horsepower, which sounds delightfully terrifying. Now, regardless of which engine you choose, the powertrain is an 8-speed automatic transmission which sends power to all four wheels as standard, as you might expect. In our particular guise with the twin charge straight six, this thing returns EPA fuel economy figures of 17 mpg city, 22 mpg freeway, and 19 mpg combined. Similar to the exterior, the interior of the Defender strikes a balance between off-road readiness and rugged materials and feeling closely related to the rest of the Land Rover lineup. Take, for example, the dash, which uses a mixture of materials that are rubberized and able to get wet and dirty and not get ruined. Also, I like the incorporation of these grab handles right here for the passenger, which is a handy touch. But what feels really special is the inclusion of this metal trim right here. This is Defender. This is actually integral and part of the bulkhead. That's really cool. Then take these front seats, for example, which are heated, and again, use a mixture of materials that are off-road ready. But what's really cool is this center console, which has these two cup holders, which is nice, but it also doubles as a jump seat. Like the rest of the Land Rover lineup, the new Defender includes Pivi Pro, which is this 10-inch infotainment display here. It's the latest system from the brand. It looks really nice, and it integrates physical buttons, knobs, and of course the use of the touchscreen here to feel really nice and easy to use while driving. Oh, and while we're looking at this area, don't forget there's a variety of plugs and chargers all over this thing, which is really handy. As previously mentioned, you can get the Defender in this two-door 90 form factor or the four-door 110 form factor, and definitely the latter is much easier to get into the second row. That said, I do manage to fit back here quite comfortably. I'm 6'1", I have enough knee room with the driver's seat in my seating position, and thanks to this cool cloth top, I have tons of headroom and great open air motoring, which is just a really fun thing about the Defender. Also cool are the inclusion of these safari sunlight windows, which I really like. Again, a lot of character back here. Speaking more practically, there's also a ton of plugs. Four here, one, two, three, four, and one in each of the seat backs, which is pretty handy, along with a variety of cup holders here in the middle and here next to the doors, making for a pretty practical second row. As you might expect, the trunk space is a little tight, but that's all right because the second row seats do fold down flat. But while we're back here, I do want to show you some cool features about the Defender's cargo area. Now, first things first is getting things into or out of this can be a bit tricky depending on how tall or how short you are. Fortunately, there's a button here that will actually raise or lower the vehicle. That's really handy for loading heavy items. Moving beyond that, we have a few storage cubbies throughout the trunk space, which is pretty nice. And of course, there's actually a plug to charge your devices back here as well, which is quite handy. The Defender's heritage is steeped in off-road performance and basically being undefeatable all over the globe. And so Land Rover knew that in bringing back the Defender, they had to make a seriously capable machine to take on things like the Jeep Wranglers of the world. And fortunately, it would seem as if they've delivered. Because especially in this short wheelbase 90 form factor, this thing has some serious capability. Thanks to an adjustable air suspension, we have 11.5 inches of ground clearance at maximum ride height. And the big thing that Land Rover is touting is the fact that in terms of water crossings, this thing can wade through 3 feet of standing water, no problem. It also helps that thanks to this short form factor and especially that really aggressive rear end, the approach and departure angles for this thing are pretty impressive, which means it won't get hung up on rocks and boulders on the trail. Speaking of the trail, a big thing with modern Land Rovers is actually their off-road tech, and of course Defender is no exception. There's a drive mode selector down here, and unlike most vehicles, the drive mode selector for the Defender does notably change the driving experience. We can toggle between gravel, snow, mud and ruts, sand, rock crawling, wading through water, and a configurable personalized selection. And the differences in the personality are very noticeable, especially in what I have right now, the rock and ruts setting. Because we can engage the 2-speed transfer case and effectively have low range gearing for that 8-speed transmission, it does make this thing very, very capable off-road. Add in tech like hill descent control, and this thing should basically tackle anything you throw at it. Oh, and don't forget, of course, locking differentials and a great display here showing pertinent off-road information. While the new Defender has absolutely maintained its off-road creds, in the 21st century, it needs to work on the roads as well. And I'm happy to report that this thing is fantastic on the pavement. Unlike a lot of the competition, Defender has independent suspension at all four corners with double wishbone suspension. And that means that this thing actually rides and handles quite nicely. Unlike the Jeep Wrangler, whose steering is akin to using a psychic medium to try and communicate with spirits far away, you're never really sure how well it's working, the Defender actually has steering feel. There's a direct correlation between my steering inputs and what the front tires are doing, which is nice. Of course, I'm kidding the Wrangler about its steering feel, but it really is impressive hopping into the Defender how well this thing handles for how high riding it is. This thing can hustle through a corner, which is actually reassuring in a way that a lot of its competition isn't. Though a big part of that hustle is definitely this powertrain. Being both supercharged and turbocharged and having a mild 48-volt hybrid assist system, the power delivery is instantaneous. It's actually uncanny how much torque this thing produces. And the 8-speed transmission does a great job of keeping the engine in its enormous flexible power band. Despite the straight six making a nice refined noise in typical straight six fashion, I am very curious to see how that new V8 Defender drives. I think that would be an absolute laugh, having experienced that powertrain in other Jag Land Rover products in the past. And it's funny to think that we live in this world where you can get these high riding, off-road ready machines that, if you want, you can stuff really big potent engines under the hood. I mean, you can go out and order a Ford Bronco Raptor, or you can drive the fantastic Jeep Wrangler 392 that we reviewed on this channel with its bonkers 6.4 liter naturally aspirated V8. And so I suppose with its mere 5 liters of displacement and a supercharger, the V8 Defender, I guess, makes sense in this modern world we live in. That said, if you don't want or need that absolute extreme performance, the standard Turbo 4 is actually a great powertrain choice, as is this boosted 6. If you go with either of these options, you'll be very pleased. It's a bit funny referencing things like the Ford Bronco or a Jeep Wrangler against the Defender, because this thing has a $53,000 base price, and our test vehicle is 66 grand as tested. And that V8 Defender, like I mentioned, is over 100 grand, which is notably more expensive than the American competition. But when you look towards Europe, well, the only thing you really have there that can kind of go toe-to-toe with the Defender is the G-Wagon. And a G-Wagon is actually hilariously more expensive than this, making this kind of a great middle choice, because this is way more refined than the Bronco or a Wrangler, but much less expensive than the G-Wagon. I think the most direct competition to the Defender actually comes from within Land Rover. You see, if you don't need the absolute off-road utility of the Defender, the Land Rover Discovery strikes me as a great alternative to this, because while this feels more like an off-road toy, that trades some off-road utility for on-road civility and a much more posh interior. So be honest and ask yourself, how much off-roading are you really gonna do? Because as fun as the Defender is to look at and to drive, if you want a more posh everyday experience, that's where the Discovery will absolutely shine, while not losing that much of the utility. With all of that said, I absolutely love the Defender. I love looking at it. I love driving it. I just love the personality of this thing. I mean, yes, it has so much personality, especially in two-door Defender 90 form. And so this revival of a historic name is definitely a success in my opinion. And I encourage you to go drive one of these things because it is just so charming. So if you want to learn more about the new Land Rover Defender or some of the competition I've mentioned in this video, you can click the link in the description down below or go to autobytel.com.